Are we lean and mean with no caffeine going into October with a full head of steam? I hope so. I certainly am. Welcome to October. Maybe we'll have an October surprise. I was getting onto a freeway. I got onto the on-ramp, you know, turned like this and was going up onto the freeway, and suddenly I faced the western sky, and the entire sky from the horizon to all overhead and 180 degrees in both directions. You could see it was sort of flat land, was just completely lit up with this, the most beautiful sunset I've ever seen. It was so spectacular. I just about, I shocked. It was shocking. You came upon this. It was just this orange and with slight strikes of blue on the sides of it. Good grief! It took my breath away. It was so startling. Never seen a sunset, even a picture of a sunset that nice. So this is rather extraordinary. Not only that, I today I was walking and I lifted my head up, and there were these five turkeys, big male turkeys, you know, huge, tall heads with the golden tails. They were all standing in a group there on this little hill, very close to me, like about 20 feet away, just looking at me, all still as statues, just looking at me. And I just stopped and looked at them. I was so shocked. You don't think that you're walking along and you lift your head up and there are these five huge turkeys just standing there, like saying, hello, how are you? You know, like, we're just looking at you. Here's looking at you, kid. and then deer today, so many deer. So what's going on here? The most beautiful sunset ever. It's a good sign, isn't it? Very good sign. Perhaps we ride off into the sunset, somehow transported into a better situation. You know, maybe it's just a sign that the great beauty is coming in October. Something staggering beauty is coming. It was staggering. That sunset, I could hardly drive. You know, it was that extraordinary. Never seen anything like the way that was stratified in layers, layer after layer after layer after layer, all beautifully puffed together in certain ways, and the orange was just brilliantly crimson, and wow, then gradually it turned more reddish, but it didn't last long. It didn't last long, no. So there's a different kind of wow, but it left an imprint. You know, it's like I felt this huge wow after seeing it. Still feel wild. He's like, how? You don't see something like that every day by any stretch of the imagination. So maybe this is a great sign for October. October is, for me, always the spiritual month of the year. This is where I've always experienced the most profound spiritual experiences. We say goodbye to September. And speaking of that, September, I had a great insight today about a dream I had before 9/11 happened, and it showed me 9/11 actually happening and George Bush being the president. I didn't even know who he was. That was several years. It was like 1998 or something. I had no idea who George Bush was. He was some governor of Texas. I don't pay attention to politics, and it had his name on the license plate, his initials on the license plate of this car, and I saw these jets coming into the picture and then causing severe instability, almost, you know, I saw the whole timeline of the future, and at the end of this timeline, what happened was we were being led on the left. There was somebody on the left. On the right side, this car had crashed and burned, the car of state of the United States of America. Somehow it had crashed and burned, and it was dead. You know, the I guess it means the greatness of America, the ideology, what made us great, died. And I was disconsolate. Really, I was inconsolable in that dream, seeing this happen. It symbolized the death of the American spirit. And then on the left, there was some figure, some shadowy figure. And this figure was leading us then down the road. And there was this dark tunnel, okay, in the side of a mountain, there was this tunnel, pitch black tunnel. Now I say, what is important with that? Well, the Holy Spirit said, hey, just take the first three letters of the tunnel. T-U-N. V-U-N. V-U-N. And I said, oh, wow. Okay, and now I get it. Now I get it. Agenda 21. This is where the world is being taken into, this tunnel of extreme darkness. Okay, so that was a big moment to recognize. Oh, this is what we're looking at. All right, so it's good to know this. It's good to know this. We look forward to October being, you know, our month now. It's the Holy Spirit's month, really. It's the Holy Spirit's month. September belonged to the UN, the Illuminati, the New World Agenda, Agenda 21. They kicked it off and are now full speed ahead with this. Full speed ahead, pointing to December and the climate change talks in Paris, which is supposed to provide some real teeth to this whole agenda. And this in September was so important. The Sustainable Development Goals, SDG Summit, was very important to gain super momentum for the Paris climate talks. That's why the Pope and the President were so adamant. They put the full press on, didn't they? Chinese Premier, the Russian Premier, everyone was here. Everyone was here putting the full press on for the December climate change talks in Paris. And as I have said, the Holy Spirit's told me, when we go into 216, yeah, it's going to be a different playing field. It really is. And this will continue through June 21st, 2016, at which time we will be in this agenda. The world will be locked into this agenda. Fundamentally, structurally, legally, we will be tied into this agenda. We will be penned into this agenda at that time. Okay, so we had better have the wow in our lives, experience so much wow by that time that we're able to handle a really, really big wow, helpful wow. This is why we say we're walking together in the wow. The more wow experiences we have, the better, okay, right now. Wow, wow, just keep going every day, keep going. The whole purpose of this channel here is to bring us into that wow. And the reason why this is helpful, I'm able to do this, is because I'm willing to get into the wow. You see, most of us try to avoid it because it's stressful and you need a lot of discipline. You need to be patient. But I'm willing to get into that wow. And so ultimately, you know, like just seeing that sunset tonight. I mean, the next time I see something that beautiful, I'll say wow too, but I'll say, okay, it's not quite as shocking. I just like, oh, okay, this is beautiful, wonderful, let me enjoy it. But the first time, it's really startling, very startling. So we intentionally startle ourselves by glimpsing something better within, yes, or without. It's all the same, actually. There's no real separation at all, but by glimpsing better and better and better and better and better, wow, 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 we become ready for even better situation, okay, to arise. So this is the training. This is the training. So every day you should pray, let today just be full with intense wow, wowness, intense wowness. Now, I wanted to be, you know, my weight down. I want to be in better shape. Going into October is very important, and I believe I've met those goals. Fortunately, I've met those goals. I managed to hold the line through September. Congratulations, everybody, for getting through September. That was maybe the toughest month in history to maintain your momentum through that. And I said, don't react to anything that happens in September. I did pretty good with that. I was able to at least restrain and, you know, get through it successfully. Which, if I hadn't have had this admonition to, you know, don't react to anything happens in September to October, I probably would have gotten pulled down into it. So it was a successful voyage through September, and now we get to voyage through October. And October could be full of tremendous, wonderful wowness. This is what I asked the Holy Spirit for, just a campaign of nonstop wowness. So whatever I try to put up here, whether it's graphics or anything, it's designed to get us used to something that's more and more sublime, more and more sublime, deeper and deeper insight. So that it feels normal to us. You see, normalizing this. it's still beautiful and everything, but it feels normal. The shock factor has worn off. We say, "Oh yeah, I'm used to this. This is normal." Kind of like golf, hitting great shots. You know, if it gets normal to you, you're not startled by it. You just say, "Yeah, that's just what I do." You know, or anything else you do. If you have some great success. I went out today. I'm trying to push myself as much as possible to get in some sort of shape by October, and so at least I've done some of that. Absolutely, and struggled mightily. What I was doing wasn't working, but I was able to finally come up with something, pull it together, and come up with something that really works spectacularly, and. It was some wow factor, like wow, they're great, great, wow. So you want to find something that really works great for you, and this is what we're after in all ways, something that really, really, really say, oh, this is it, this is the ticket, this is the neither nor practice, which I did all much of the day, the morning and most of the day I was doing the neither nor practice. Tremendously, tremendously helpful. Is we get just used to it. It's not a matter of getting results right away. The results we're looking for is actually simply to get used to it. That's all. Nothing spectacular happens or anything. You know, we just find ourselves getting used to it. And at some point, a situation will arise where the familiarity with neither now, being there, just enables us to abide. It enables abidance to take place. So, as I've always said, familiarity is the key. It wins. Familiarity wins. So people are saying, "Well, where's the results? Am I going to go into some different mental condition or this is it?" No. We're not trying for those type of results necessarily at all. We're just getting familiar with this. Get familiar with it. This is what the ego continuity fear has us overlook, familiarity, because it uses familiarity to keep imprisoning us. It knows that's the key, so it doesn't want to tell us that. It'll say, no, you need to do, if you do this practice, you should go and do, samadhi, nirvana, or something, and if you don't, it's not working for you, and so better stop, wasting your time. And I say, no, continuity fear. I'm just doing it and 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 feeling like, wow, there's wow factor. I'm still functioning fine. There's no change in my functionality or anything, but I'm getting used to it. I'm getting used to it. See, this is the wisdom on the path. It's simple, but the continuity fear pretends like it's the biggest deal in the world. Like, what are you talking about? Familiarity? Well, I don't know. I don't even know what you're talking about. Familiarity. Familiarity is how continuity fear keeps us imprisoned. Okay, imprisoned with our pretense. And it so of course to slow us down and delay us, it will claim, don't work on your familiarity, don't work on it, don't work on it. No, that's crazy. It'll drive you crazy, it'll drive you insane, you're gonna go nuts, break down. Oh, this, it threatens you, threatens you, threatens you. The continuity fear threatens and threatens and threatens you. Don't do this practice, don't do this practice. Whereas the fact is, nothing happens except you get used to it. You get used to it. So we're not aiming for some breakthrough. The breakthrough happens gently. It's not really a break. It's so gentle you can't even call it a breakthrough. The times that I've slipped right into abidance, it was so gentle. Like one moment, I was not in abidance. The next instant, I'm just in it, and it was completely smooth, completely smooth. There's no sense of a breakthrough at all. You recognize, oh. Wow, I'm looking at it in a different way now. This is great. Wonderful. So we're not looking for some huge sort of mental breakthrough or anything like that. Just familiarity. This has to be stressed over and over and over because the continuity fear is really very, very, very stubborn about this. I don't know if anyone's ever heard this before, actually, in the world. I don't think I ever have. It is, yeah, these spiritual practices, what you're just doing them to get familiar with them. Isn't that an incredible concept to hear? Everybody assumes they're getting it to reach some outcome. And if they don't reach the outcome, what's the matter? I thought I was supposed to see lights and hear bells and whistles and bliss and all this stuff and chakra aligning and everything. No. Well, you just ignore all that stuff. Just keep doing it and get familiar with it. I've not seen any bells or whistles or lights or anything. But I'm getting more and more and more and more familiar with this, like it's just second nature or first nature. It's just, yeah, of course, neither nor. I'm neither succeeding nor am I not succeeding. I'm neither succeeding nor am I not succeeding. I'm neither doing this nor am I not doing this. This is neither happening nor is it not happening. And so I just go on and on and on and on, practice, 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 practice. You get familiar. This is the secret. Familiarity is the secret that the continuity fear absolutely overlooks. It tells you, oh, you're on the spiritual path where you need results. You need outcomes. And if you don't get the outcomes, go to a different teacher, do a different practice. It's not working for you. Because it doesn't want you to recognize that familiarity is what you're really after. It wants you to give up. Change. Don't get familiar with it. So you just simply say, oh, just simple. I'm doing it. I'm just practicing it. Practice, practice every day. Practice, practice, practice. You know, it'll come a day where you just say, well, this is so easy. And it doesn't bother me the slightest bit. Why? Because I'm familiar with it. It's astonishing. Now, here's another thing I thought about today, is a very big insight that if we could get someone to come into the world and at least affirm what we're doing here, some heavyweight teacher, it would be so helpful. I likened it. I was driving to the golf course, and I suddenly thought, hey, you know what? It would be really nice to have a golf pro give me a playing lesson. And I thought, no. Well, I can't afford it. But the idea, I was just thinking about the idea. And then I suddenly changed my mind. I said, you know, I don't want him to try and tell me what to do, actually. I've always been afraid, like, no, you need to do it my way. Oh, everything we think, everything we do is wrong. You know, no, change this. No, I don't want them for that. I just want to have a playing lesson, so and then get to know the pro, the playing pro, so to speak, instruction, the pro instructor, and be on a first name basis so they know my game and everything. And then when I'm playing with, you know, other situations, if I do something like in my routine or my stance or whatever I'm doing, I can, if someone says, oh, that's kind of, you know, why are you doing that? Or, you know, how come you're doing that? You know, there is this sense of, like, on the golf course, like, people think they know the right way to do it. And they see someone do it a different way, it kind of gets them nervous, like, hey, why are you lining up like that or taking the time here? Well, if you just say, "Well, my golf pro told me to do it this way, to try it this way. Or this is what a tip a golf pro gave me, and my golf pro wants me to keep doing it this way." Or if you hit a bad shot, you know, they might say, so your stance isn't good. I say, no, my golf pro said, just if you hit a bad shot, just don't worry about it. That's going to happen to everybody, and just move on to the next shot. And so if you say, my golf pro said, he likes what I'm doing. He wants me to keep doing it. That's like authority, okay? And that just shuts them up. And what can they say? You know, you're working with a golf pro and he says, you know, try this. You know, they might say, well, you know, I don't know about your golf pro. I say, no, he's a very good golf pro. You know, I mean, you go talk to him if you don't like it. And I realize what a great help this is. What a great help. I never thought of that before. It's authority saying what you're doing is okay. Keep doing it. This is what's so important. Because then you could just, you know, brush off the criticisms which are come at you in all directions in the world, even unspoken. You know, like, for instance, there's some people like to play really fast. And if you're, like, meticulous and you line up your shot, what are you doing? You know, they kind of like, you know, I can just say, yeah, you know, I'm doing this. My golf pro wants me to do it. This is something my golf pro wants me to do. He's helping me with my game. And it's helping me out, you know, so I'm going to keep doing it with my golf pro. You know, I'm not going to take your advice. I'm going to take my golf pro's advice, you know. And then it diffuses the whole thing. What could they say? So the same thing with spiritual path. I mean, my gosh, if we can just get someone who's a real pro and just come in and not say, oh, you're doing it wrong, you got to change this, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, I'm not going to put up with that because, you know, it's like your golf game. You know what works. You know what you can do. And, you know, you might have some injuries, you might issues. You know, you know how to adapt and accommodate it. But if someone just comes in and says, yeah, keep doing what you're doing. Keep doing what you're doing. You're doing great. I like this. I like this. I like this. And I want you to keep doing this. And then you can say, oh, yeah, my spiritual teacher, you know, told me that, you know, he wants me to, you know, or he or she wants me to keep doing this. Or it, you know, he or she, or it. I mean, they're not really identified with their body at all. They told me to do that. They said they want me to keep doing this. Boom. You see how helpful that is? Super helpful. And it can cause a chain of helpfulness because then you can say, well, yeah, I'm doing this. Well, so-and-so told me to do this because and their teacher, you know, this teacher, wow, told them to do this and to give it out to others. And, you know, this is very, 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 very helpful. And I saw how helpful it could be to the world. And I was just really, really almost overcome. I said, wow, I've never seen it that way. Because I always just assume a golf pro or a spiritual pro is just going to tell you that, you know, you're doing it all wrong. And you got to change everything. And, you know, just like, oh, gosh, I don't know. It's just too tough. I don't know if I can. I don't really want to do that. I want to change everything. It's so intimidating. You know, like they just shake their heads. Ah, no, no, you're doing it completely backwards. This can't, it won't work for you. You know, I said, oh gosh, scary. You know, and they can give pointers too, a few pointers. But you know, a wise teacher is not going to try and scare you. They're going to try to say, I like what you're doing. Keep doing that. So you know, I really love the way that your routine there. And how you're you know, getting the feel for the shot and like that. He says, that's a great routine. You gotta keep doing that, okay? Just tell anybody that says anything about it that I told you, you gotta keep doing that. Because I'm, you know, you're my student. You're my student, and I want to have good students. I want my students doing it this way. So I really like doing that. And this takes the pressure off of you. It takes the pressure off. I'm under so much pressure on the golf course. I'm so unorthodox. You know, that people think, well, if you're that unorthodox, you got to hit a perfect shot every time. Otherwise, they'll say, oh, you see, it doesn't work. Whereas they're doing things an orthodox way, and they hit a bad shot. They say, no, that was just, you know, a fluke, you know, or it just happens. But I'm doing it the right way. So if you do something unorthodox, they expect it to be perfect, or else they'll start saying, ah, you see, crazy style. So anytime you're doing something different than the quote-unquote the norm, you're under a lot of pressure, social pressure, to conform. Very much so. So I actually stopped doing the unorthodox style that I was doing before because I wasn't trying to, but just the pressure. No one said anything, but I just said, wow, you know, maybe I better not do it that way so much because, it's maybe too extreme. So I got away from it, and then I started playing poorly, bad. You know, I went back to it. I started playing great again. So we don't even realize how in the back of our mind social pressure, and nowadays with social media, the pressure is just ungodly. Ungodly, which the UN is counting on, is the social media pressure. It's just, I mean, the kids on today are just, I don't know what to say, except they need a lot of help, a lot of help. The way that they're raised and brought up now, they're locked into this groupthink, social pressure sort of thing, and the UN Agenda 21 is using that to steer, to herd minds and attention, herd attention into this tunnel, the UN. Maybe the nasty elimination and the nasty NEL, nasty elimination. I don't know. It's not good. So young people, I stay away from social media. I really do. I really, really do. Just don't. You know, I just do, when in Rome, do as Rome do. I have some links up there, you know, but nobody uses them really. And there's nothing going on there because you may all be wise too, you know, like, hey, I don't want to get into social media either, which is great because it's too much pressure. So it's so it's I realize that if you're unorthodox, you have to play way better. And even then, people are skeptical, saying, "Ah, if I did that, everything would go to hell." You know, that's not what it shows in the magazines. I got to do, for me, I say, "Well, you do what works. It's not the swing; it's the shot." They're looking at the swing instead of the shot. Yeah, you can hit a perfect shot, but they say, "Ah, swing." You know, I don't know about that swing. Who cares about what the swing looks like? It's the shot that's important. This is what's important. It's the results that are important. So I'm making changes. The golf reflects life. I'm making some adjacent additions and subtractions. I took the second driver out of the bag. I put in a 3 wood. I put in a 53-degree wedge. I took the 6 iron out. You know, I'm really, you know, I'm really sort of tweaking things. And you know, this is how we go forward with spiritual practice too. We tweak this, we tweak that, make a little change here, a little change there. So, wow, would it be helpful to get help from some heavyweight teacher? I already have, but something then more, a little bit more direct, you know, a little more direct, a little stronger, a little stronger. Where I can be really certain that I got reassurance that, yeah, just, you know, keep doing what you're doing, or do it, yeah, you're doing a lot, you know, this part, this way, this way, this way, great. Maybe a little tweak here or there is fine. I don't mind that at all. And this way we can really create a push here, really make a push here. Because there has to be some authority, like for instance, like, you know, like the Kriya Yoga by Yogananda, I believe it's called that, came from his teacher, Sri Yukteswar, which came from his teacher, Lahiri Mahasaya, something like that, which came from the great immortal Babaji. So there's this lineage of saying, do this, do this, do this. So the Yogananda says, you know, do this. And people say, okay, because he's had these great teachers, you know, tell him that this will be helpful for people. Now, there are different ways to be helpful, actually, depending on a lot of different factors, actually. So, but, you know, this is what often happens is some really great teachers work through some devotee of theirs and tell them, yeah, you know, do this, tell people, you know, that I said that this is the right way to do it, and keep, you know, tell people, and this helps everybody with the authority problem, because they're doing something that normal culture doesn't really approve of, or even say, well, that's great, what's weird, I don't know. They say, well, no, I mean, you know, Jesus told me to do this practice this way, and so I'm going to do it. This would be help. I saw the helpfulness of this, really big helpfulness of it. And of course, some people are going to be grumpy, but the advice is really for those who really want abidance. You see, this is what we want. We want abidance. We don't want to just, you know, get one glimpse of a sunset. We want to abide in that sunset. We want to see the sky like this. Wow. So, for those who want abidance, it's very helpful to feel that what they're practicing is backed up by some, you know, great teachers who say, you know, right now, this is what we're recommending. We like this. And yeah, I mean, so this is what I can do. This is what I believe in. Now, the great teachers know many, many, many different ways, really. So it's not like they're saying, well, this is the only way there is necessarily. They're not going to say that. But the fact that they may be endorsing this and saying, do it like this right now, doesn't mean that that will always be the case necessarily, right? There may be someone else come along and with something, some slightly different approach, etc. But it does mean that this does work. This is very helpful. They want it, you know, that they're advising this, like a good golf pro saying, "Hey, I like that you're hitting the shots, you know, real straight, really nice. You know, that's working for you. You know, I want you to keep doing that because it's good for you. It's working. I don't want you to try to change it. If someone tries to tell you to change it, say, forget it. I had to go talk to me. I'll set them straight. I'll tell them, no, I told them to do this." So it's wonderful, and I see the benefit of like wealthy people can afford a golf pro. I saw the benefit today. I said, wow. Because they always say, oh, no, I'm just working on some things my golf pro wants me to work on. They go out and play golf. They just say that, you know. Yeah, I just work, my golf pro wants me to work on a couple things here, and so I'm just out here doing that. And it's kind of like, you know, what can you say to that? You know, it's like one up to you, you know? It's just like, wow. And if they hit something, the shot isn't working, doesn't, something, they say, well, no, I'm just, you know, oh, they're just working on something, their golf pro, you know, they're just, that's what they're doing, and, you know, whether it be course management or this and this and this, and you can say course management, yeah, my golf pro wants me to try to hit it pin high, you know, and this is a question, like, do you try to hit it pin high, or you try to get it on the green? This is like a big question, you know, that I have, you know, and, most golfers will try to hit it on the green, really. And then they think that they can two putt from there, but I'm starting to think, like, actually try to get it pin high, even if it's in the rough, and just get better and better at chipping. And if you really learn how to chip properly, you can get up and down, you know, almost every time. And it's probably better than just hitting it on the green. I don't know. That's an interesting question. And then spiritually, we have questions too, right? Like, should I do it this way? Should I do it this way? Should I try and get it pin high, even though I'm, should I try to get, you know, neither nor practice, or should I try to just get, you know, in the vicinity, then try to get a little closer? And it's different approaches, right? But I'm leaning towards trying to get as close to the pin as possible, even if you go in the rough. And then just get better and better and better of chipping, so you can get it within like 4 feet almost every time. And you know, that's actually better than if you're like 60 feet away on the green, with a bunch of hills and stuff go through, you know, and elevation changes and slope, and hit a putt, you might be 10 feet away. You know, it's difficult to get it close from that far away, so it may be better just to, you know. So I'm just seeing a change, you know, in philosophy, change in philosophy. So we may, with this neither nor practice, it gets us very close to abidance, even though it may feel a little rough for us, you know, like it doesn't feel so smooth or something. But as we keep practicing something that gets us real close, even though it may not feel real smooth, it may actually be a, you know, more advantageous, way more advantageous for us. And so I changed my whole philosophy. Like, for example, par fives. Now I'm thinking, you know what? Just try to hit as, you know, two shots as, you know, as far as you can hit them. Just try to get it up there close to the pin, and then just work on pitching and chipping, getting it close. And that's probably, you know, it could turn out to be an actually better strategy. I said, wow. So I changed my, I put a 3 wood in my bag. I said, let me try this. Let me just go. This is how the pros play. They just hit as far as they can, and just try to get it, you know, up close to the pin, basically. Most of the time, most of the time. Especially on par fives, they just want to get up close to the green, and then they let their short game take over. And so we're trying to get it close to abidance, you know, get it close. And then let these little refinements take over. All right, little refinements. So we make these real strong push. This neither nor practice is an extraordinarily strong push. Just get familiar with it. Familiar, 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 familiar. And it gets us close. It gets us close to abidance. So is everyone, like in golf, has a different game, you know, and everyone should try to play the game, you know, the way that they can play it. But they should not be afraid to, you know, make some changes as they go along. Their philosophy may change. So as we go along here, we've introduced some practices that, like, wow, you know, instead of like assertions, we're now doing this, you know, neither nor, which is even more powerful than assertions. It gets us real close to abidance, but it doesn't seem that way because we're not asserting anything positively. We're just getting used to this neutrality, as it were. Expressional neutrality. Can we have expressional neutrality? Sure. Why not? And then once we get used to this expressional neutrality, then it should be easy to get into abidance, actually. Just like once you get up, like, you know, you're like just 10 feet away from the whole golf, the pin, but you're in the rough a little bit. But you say, well, that's no problem. I've got the tools here to get out, and I can chip it within, you know, within 6 inches or something, or a foot. Easy. I remember I played with a guy like that. He hit it so far, tried to get it up, got it up there. He had it in the rough every single time, and he just pitched it up real close and knocked the putt in every time. It's like, wow. It's amazing. That's how he played the game. Most of us are, like, for instance, I'm using this analogy, it's a very good analogy for spiritual path. Most of us are afraid to, you know, get in the rough. It's, I struggle in it, you know, because why they take just one club, like a, you know, a pitching wedge or some sort of wedge. But I'm taking now three, and actually I'm going to take four now, four different wedges with me. And anytime I have to chip, four different wedges. And just try each one, try and see what, you know, it makes a huge difference. If you get the right wedge and then just put the right swing, it's going the distance. You can have distance control, you know, really well. So you don't see many people doing that, taking four wedges with them, because it's not orthodox. So they keep struggling with just one wedge, trying to use it in all different conditions. And that makes it very, very difficult, actually. Very difficult. Whereas if you use different degrees, different wedges, you can keep the swing pretty much the same every time and just use different lofts to control your distance instead of trying to change your stance and the angle of the club every time, you know, trying to manipulate the club. That's very, very, very difficult. You have to, like, play every day to be able to do that sort of, do that kind of thing. It's real difficult. But you just don't see people, again, taking four wedges with them. You just don't see it. But it's actually very, very helpful. So, see, there are things that can be done that are helpful, but we just don't do it because it doesn't seem normal or orthodox to people. So there are spiritual practices like this, neither nor. You know, where do you hear anyone practicing this? Well, it's not orthodox, you know. So they say, well, you know, I don't want to do that, you know. And people will think that I'm not very advanced if I do that. You know, I said, well, we're not, you know, right now with this UN agenda, we don't really care what people say about us. And if we could just get a great teacher to say, hey, you know, this is what I really think that what they won't tell us you have to do this because it would feel pressure. But they say, you know what, I really like what you're doing. I really like it. And if you can keep doing it, I think it would be really great if you could keep doing it. Don't, you know, don't just abandon it. And then we could say, hey, you know, somebody's grumpy about it. Say, whatever. You know, well, I'm going to keep doing this. I want to have game here. I got to have game now because the UN is rigging the situation. It's so rigged. It's so rigged. We don't realize how deeply it is rigged, the situation here. The media is all in on it. You know, bureaucracies, governments, heads of state, they're all in on it. Education's all in on it. Social media is all in on it. Television, entertainment, all in on it. Entertainment's very much in on it. You have so much that's all in on this agenda, folks. You know, just start adding it up. Corporations are all in on it. You start thinking, well, who isn't all in on it? You know, well, some mavericks. You know, people say, hey, I'm. But institutionally, the institutions of the world are all in on it, which the Pope just made very clear. The Catholic Church is all in on this, on the UN agenda, all in. 1.2 billion people, Catholics in the world, the Pope has affirmed unequivocally and unabashedly that the Catholic Church is going to be all in on this Agenda 21. There is no doubt about it. And he says, he was, you know, sound to pious, like we must respect the human being, the human person. And of course, he's going to throw those little, you know, sound bites in there. But he made it crystal clear that he is all in on this entirely. This is what he wants. This is what he's going to, this is the direction he's aiming the church. And, you know, the church, the people are so scared of the church. It's for, in terms of, you know, they're afraid if they don't get the Eucharist, they won't go to heaven. So they say, I don't want to leave the church. They may not give me the Eucharist. And so they say, well, I got to keep getting it, so I better not say anything. It's a nice control mechanism to say that, you know, the authority structure has to give you something in order for you to get to heaven. So they can always threaten to take it away from you if you don't agree with them, right? This is the problem, right, with the Eucharist. It's a big problem. So they tend to toe the line, even though they may not agree. I can guarantee you a lot of Catholics don't agree with this at all. But they will bite their lip and, you know, and say, well, you know, as long as I get the Eucharist, everything will be fine. And so this is what 1-2 billion people on the planet, you know, are going to, you know, believe that they may not believe it at all, but they'll say, I got to get that Eucharist, and if I do, doesn't matter what happens or what I believe or whatever, you know, I'm good. So they'll go along with it, so to speak, go along to get along. And then you have all the secular humanists in the world, which are ruling every nation in the world, basically, almost, are secular humanists, have gone through a secular humanist education, upbringing, culture, acculturization. They're all in on it too. So who isn't all in on it? I don't know. It's hard to find. I mean, there's, like I said, they're just like some strong individuals who can think for themselves, who say, hey, wait a minute. You know, listening to the Holy Spirit, they'll say, hey, wait a minute, the Holy Spirit just is showing me something. And, you know, so there are those who are not all in on it, but they don't represent an institution is the problem. They do not really represent an institution. They're just kind of, you know, mavericks here and there kind of things. So this is a big trouble. This is a big trouble because you end up feeling isolated. And it's so important to have some institutions speak out and say, no, we're not, we've decided we're not going to agree with Agenda 21, and we're going to tell all our people that we represent that we're going to pursue a different agenda. You know, where are you hearing that? All 193 countries, signatories to the United Nations, all signed the Sustainable Development Goals, SDG, agenda. They all signed it. They all signed it. So where is an institution in the world, a big institution, that's just standing up and say, no, 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 no. This isn't right. This is going into spiritual darkness. And say, we have a better goal. A better goal. That's all I need to hear. That's all I need to hear. I mean, there's a few Protestant pastors, you know, who have a church somewhere, you know, and a congregation, and they're speaking up about it, right? But they don't represent the mainstream of the entire, you know, they have a church somewhere. That they're still mavericks. You see, they're still mavericks. The mainstream is, even mainstream Protestantism is going for Agenda 21. You know, they're the ones who are putting up the most resistance is the Protestants, for sure. They have a long history of trying to resist institutional, you know, enslavement, and so they're feistier. And some of the pastors will be feisty about it and say, no, we're, you know, but more and more of the conferences of the leadership of these Protestant denominations are going along with Agenda 21. Absolutely, they're voting and deciding. Okay, you know, we're going to go along with this. So, where do you go? Where do you go for help now that you feel there's some authority backing you up? This is what I've been saying over and over for so long. I said, hey, Holy Spirit, look, we're getting crushed, institutionally crushed here. What do you think? We just can stand up to this just as some isolated maverick? This is not reasonable at all, actually. We need some help. We need some authoritative help. So far, you know, I've gotten some help subtly. No question about it. I told you about Ron Maharshi. He told me, came up to me in a dream and told me he loved what I was doing. And he says, don't change. No matter what anyone says, don't change. Just keep doing what you're doing. You're gonna be very helpful to many, many. I already know. So that was like an example. Someone was super helpful for me. It saved my life, actually. Because I said, hey, if Ramana Maharshi says to keep doing it, I'm going to keep doing it, right? Because he has great authority, spiritual authority. So that wasn't exactly, I know how helpful this is. It's super helpful. I've been able to withstand, you know, from that point, like 15 years of pressure. So where does the help come from? A Course in Miracles community? I've never had anyone in A Course in Miracles really stand up for me and say, I love what you're doing, you know, keep doing it. And no, hasn't happened. Hasn't happened at all. So, you know, I haven't gotten it from there as far as encouragement and some sort of authoritative, you know, pat on the back saying, yeah, don't change. I try to give help to others saying, but basically, they don't listen. Like, who's he? I don't know. You know, what authority does he have? It doesn't really carry a lot of weight. So, you know, we need someone weighty. This is what guru means, weighty. Someone's very heavy, very weighty, very profound, you know, very, carries a great deal of authority, like Ramana Maharshi carries so much authority. By the way, the previous video, I did a quote that I said that I believe this is from Ramana Maharshi. It probably was from Annamalai Swami, who was a close devotee of Ramana Maharshi and actually reached abidance also after 20 years of quiet meditation in a hut. He spent 10 years as a personal attendant with Ramana Maharshi and then a building superintendent of the Ramana Ashram, and then he spent 20 years in meditation, and he finally entered into abidance. And so it may have been, the book was titled something with Bhagavan Ramaharshi, I think it's probably by David Godman, and I thought it was Ramana speaking, but I also said maybe it's, you know, someone else. But what's important is what's said. Okay, what's important is what is said, but of course also is important who's saying it, because it gives some authority to it. So it may have been Swami Annamalai Swami. But what he's saying is the same as what Ramana Maharshi is saying. It's the same. He isn't as famous. You know, he's not as nearly as famous. Doesn't carry the same weight. But he seemed to have a realization similar like to Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj. There's a Ramana Maharshi's realization seemed to be very, very powerful in how it expressed itself here. And, you know, why that happens, I don't know, but it does happen. So if we get Ramana, you know, to appear in this world and start telling people, hey, you know, I like what you're doing, keep doing it, you've got my blessing to do this. This would be super helpful, even though people will say, oh, you're just making it up, you're crazy, it never happened. But if it actually happens, you know it happened, you're just going to brush that off and say, you know, you're just being grumpy, that's all, and you just, you know, want to keep being lazy. Well, okay, if you want to keep being lazy, go ahead. But I know, You know, I know this has been, I've given, you know, a blessing to do this. So I hope we get this in October. I hope we get this. This is what I'm working towards, to be able to handle the wow of this sort of situation. You come across someone like Ram Maharshi, it'd be like coming across the sunset. Oh my God, you know, it's just stupendously beautiful. Never seen anything like it. And he would say, you know, he might say, you know, look, I'm giving my blessings to you know, what you're doing. Keep doing it and tell others to do it. And let's get this going now. It's time. It's time, isn't it? I mean, we've got no time to waste right now. I said the Holy Spirit's going to roll out its response to the Holy Spirit's rollout. So we'll see how the Holy Spirit rolls it out. Like I said, there was deer everywhere today. I've never seen so many deer in my life. And they were just looking at me and, you know, kind of letting me go by. And they would just kind of scoot off to the edge a little bit, you know. And it was just, but just so many, 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 many deer. Very, very powerful to see that. So maybe we'll get something stupendous that then people will start saying, hey, you know what? Let's get with this, you know. We've got the word that we need to, you know, practicing this way, it will be beneficial. It's a way to avoid the, you know, Agenda 21. And you can Google that if you don't know what it is, Agenda 21. It's been this long-term goal. They named it in 92, Agenda 21, but it actually, they've been working towards this for a long, long time. And as I've said before, It's a solution in search of a problem to justify itself. And it's a technocratic dictatorship, in my opinion. And they couldn't get the world to go along with it when the population of the density of the planet was low, lower than, much lower than it is now. Let's say like a 1.5 or 2 billion or something, 1.5 or 2 billion. It was spread out, you know, people were very much individualistic and felt freedom, and they wouldn't go along with this. So what they did was they had to then create a problem that would beg for their solution. And the problem is overpopulation. 3 billion now, going towards 7.5. I mean, this is, and the use of resources and everything that's going on the planet. And so now they can say, oh my gosh, we have a crisis. We need to really control everything. But in truth, I believe, and many do believe, that these technocrats and these elites, their real goal is depopulation of the planet. And they want to, like the Georgia Guidestones say, they want to take it down to 500 million. And they want to be in total control of this planet. They want elites controlling these 500,000 people are being controlled. They want to keep it at that. And they want to have their nice little planet, you know, the way they want it. And so, but first, they had to get this crisis so people go, oh my gosh, help, 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 United Nations, please help, you know. Well, you know, show us the way. And they say, oh yeah, no problem. We'll show you the way. We'll solve the problems. But at some point, once they get enough control over the population and change the laws and destroy the sovereignty, maybe the money, you know, crash the money systems of everyone, go to digital currency, at some point, they may very well start depopulating the planet. Okay, this is very possible. I don't know how high to put the possibility, you know, maybe 70% or something. I want to keep an open mind because this is a terrible thing to say, you know. It's like, think about it, like, oh my gosh, really? There are certainly a lot of indications that this may be what they're going after, but they couldn't have done it directly previously, really. They may have tried with the world wars, but the spreading out of people in a less dense way, you know, where there's plenty of natural resources and everything. Everybody will say, no, wait a minute, we everything's fine the way it is. We don't need your Agenda 21. Forget it, you know. And the church might say, no, you know, we're not going to go for that. But now, you know, people are saying, oh yeah, my gosh, you know, the ocean's dying, everything's dying, the ocean's dying, climate change is going to kill us all. Everyone's in this paranoid state. Very paranoid state, probably oversold. All this stuff's probably very oversold, actually. They pay these scientists to come up with these conclusions. Science is very corrupt right now. And everyone's panicking. So they come in and say, "Hey, don't worry, we have the sustainable development goals. We're going to monitor everybody and make sure that they all, you know, this is good for everybody because we're saving the planet, saving our home." And people say, "Oh, this is great. Thank you so much. Let's get with it." And everybody will get with it. And at some point, they might say, "You know what? You know, it's still so severe, and some people just don't get it. We got to start culling them a little bit here." And, you know, the culling process will begin. A lot of people feel that way, and they're probably not off the mark, you know. I don't want to overemphasize that because it tends to freeze us up and get us rather frightened. And hopefully, you know, it doesn't go this way. That would just be, you know, but look at the history of the world. It's not a nice history. And what is it that's changed? Is something fundamentally changed, you know, in our psyche? Well, looking at what's wrong with us and really knowing what it is, nothing has changed. Well, we haven't changed at all. Not really. We've gotten just more organized and sophisticated. You know, maybe the culling might be, you know, global this time. Maybe we just have better colors right now. But as far as the fear and projection and feeling of threat, continuity fear, fear of ending pretense, you know, trying to defend against that, trying to believing in magic, a magical solution that will bless our illusions and make them real, that hasn't changed at all. In fact, it's worse than ever. And you know, like I said before, that the goal, what the belief system of the world is to believe in magic. The belief in magic now is stronger than it's ever been. It's extraordinarily strong, especially the young people. They're obsessed with magic. And this is very, very bad. It's a sure sign of severe trouble. And ultimately, they believe that there's going to be some sort of transformation of illusions and they'll become real. You know, this is what they're going for because they're not doing the spiritual practice, which really enables us to set down pretense, set down illusion. Realize there's no such thing as any outcomes. They're looking to make outcomes reality, which means lack of freedom, concretization, reality. And they think that there's a way to do this through some sort of magical blessing from a goddess. Now, why not God? Because we've been doing it, waiting for God to bring about a transformation for thousands of long time. It hasn't happened. And so people are saying, well, it hasn't happened because the goddess is the one that has the real power, that actually she has greater power than God. That's why the blessing hasn't happened. So we have to please the goddess. And once we please her, she'll be able to bless illusions and make them real, bless lies and make them true. And this is called the magic, the believing in magic. Okay, the world is very heavily invested in magic. Materialism is magic, actually. Materialism is magic. Okay, it's a belief in magic. If the materialistic path, the belief in the body beautiful and all this, is belief in magic. That there's some, we'll be able to some, you know, magic believes in rituals. They use rituals to conjure up some result, magical result. And so this is what the world's doing. They're getting more and more ritualistic. They're getting more and more into bodies, into materialism. And they believe that at some point, this is going to cause the goddess to finally release her blessing upon the illusion of outcome and concretization and time, space, process, and form, which is all simply our imagination. We made it up. It's not real. And but we believe that then her blessing somehow will make it real. And so we don't have to deal with the continuity problem at all. It'll be a non-factor at that point, you see. This is, you know, this is the what the path of those going into UN, the United, you know, Agenda 21, this is what they believe in. So, those who have believed in magic can do very, very nasty things in this world, and they have throughout history. The end justifies the means. They said, this is what the goddess wants. She tells us that because they have to keep making excuses because it doesn't work. So they have to keep believing it works and somehow explain why it doesn't, hasn't yet worked. Well, somebody is bad, you know, is getting in the way. They got to be eliminated. And once we eliminate them, the goddess will say, oh, thank you. I didn't like them. You see, they made me feel unwelcome. So now that I've got rid of them, now I feel welcome. Now I can give my full blessing, except it's almost there, but just not quite. I still feel a little something, you know. This, I'm not sure what might it be. And we started thinking, you know, yeah, we'll come up with it. Don't worry, goddess, we'll come up with it really quickly. And then we come up with thinking, another projection, a threat. It's like, oh, those people over there, yeah, that must be what it is. You know, they're not quite like us. And then go attack them, get rid of them, and you think, okay, now the goddess is ready to release her blessing upon illusion and make it real. And it just goes on and on and on and on and on and on and on like that. So I don't see any reason why history won't repeat itself now. The way that people who are following the UN Agenda 21 talk on the internet, they're ready to call right now. I mean, they're ready for the order to start calling right this moment. They're ready to go at it. This should get your attention, right? I mean, they're like pit bulls. They're ready to go at it. I mean, the pit bulls are nice and sweet dogs, except when the owner tells them to get somebody, then they turn into monsters. So, I think a lot of people are in the world right now are like pit bulls. They got a pit bull mentality. This pit bull mentality has been spreading for quite some time. Of course, we've been through this whole thing about people owning pit bulls and taking them everywhere with them. I mean, and it scares people, you know, because the dog seems okay. But if they know, if they say, hey, I feel really threatened, attack, the dog's going to attack you, and you're in big trouble. He's not going to let go. You know, we've been trying to pass laws to try to, but there's still so many people with pit bulls. It's amazing. This represents a pit bull mentality, is someone who appears to be socially functional and nice, and yet can turn into a raging maniac that won't stop. This can happen. They're just waiting for the orders. I've been aware of this for a long time. There's so many people in this world who have this pit bull mentality, and once they're just waiting for the order. Once they get it, they're gonna flip. They're gonna flip out. And you get this like in the inner cities of some of these riots and stuff. The people suddenly, well, they burn the city down, right? They just flip out. They're ready to flip out. They're ready to go attack the police. They're ready to, you know, just anarchy, chaos, you know. Just give us the word. They're just waiting for some rabble-rouser to give them the word. And you might have seen them on the street the day before, and hey, how you doing, man? They're joking and laughing, and then the next day, you know, they're absolutely flipped out. So I expect some flip-out to happen, actually. And in fact, in that dream I told you about, of going to that dark tunnel, the tunnel, the United Nations, right before that happened, there was this big flip out. The car flipped over. It was represented the United States, but it flipped upside down. It flipped like a flip out. It flipped. And I saw these flames. It was burning. So we should look for a situation where people start burning cities, start burning this. Well, we've already had this, haven't we? Before Agenda 21, before the Sustainable Development Goals, we had Baltimore, we had, Ferguson, we had various places, and then we have, you know, ISIS. People are flipping out in terms of behaving like maniacs, actually. Burn, baby, burn. So that part of the dream may have already been fulfilled. I don't know. Or maybe it's going to get a lot worse. California's had extraordinary wild. The West has had extraordinarily terrible wildfires this year. I haven't been paying attention to them. I know people have houses in that area, and a couple people told me. But actually, as far as news, I haven't even looked at it or paid attention. As per us not paying attention to the news so much anymore. But yeah. I've never even seen anything about the, you know, Oregon or Washington fires or anything, but someone told me it's like incredibly, incredibly bad. So maybe that is part of the burning, you know, the United States is burning. Burning with pit dog mentality, you know, people wanting to, you know, burn civilization down to the ground. Those who they feel are preventing them from being happy, you know, get rid of them. It's like criminals say, hey, you know, I'm not happy because of the police. They're the reason I'm not happy. if there were no police, I could just rob any bank I wanted to, and it'd be great, you know. So they're only thinking about their own happiness and not, you know, the functionality of society in terms of that, in those terms. It's a negative kind of, so yet it makes sense to them. Now, shifting gears just a little, I did see the Holy Spirit wanted to get my attention just today. One little story, it managed to do that. I said, okay, I'll look at that. I'll look at that. Just took a little peek at it. Russian airstrikes in Syria have started. And I said, wow. Uh-oh. Right? Uh-oh. And so those who did say that the Russians are moving military equipment in the areas, they were right. Building airfields and all, they were right. They were right. And now we have an alliance, you know, taking place with Russia and Iran and Syria. And so you get these alliances in the Middle East now, and people have to be saying, wait a minute, this sounds a lot like Armageddon is getting very, very close, doesn't it? Man, you get the BRIC countries. I think that's, what is it, Brazil, Russia, India, and China. Making various alliances, and then you have a recipe there for Armageddon that's taking place right now. So seems like the Bible, you know, is certainly not being refuted in its what it has said, right? I mean, you can't really say, oh, look, everything that's happening is completely different than what the Bible said, so it's all wrong. Okay, no, nobody can say that. Nobody can say that. I mean, those who, you know, try to want to say the Bible is just nonsense, you know, they really don't have a leg to stand on right now. Now, of course, anybody can read anything they want to into it. They can read anything they want to into a comic book if they want to. So it doesn't mean that if someone does that, that the Bible is necessarily wrong or mistaken. It's just, you know, that it certainly seems that there's a lot of prophetic value there. You know, I don't know the details about any of this stuff. I'm not following any stories. I just know that a little blurb. I said, okay, so maybe Armageddon is on the way. World War III is on the way. Okay, fine. Holy Spirit, roll out your agenda, you know, your option. Roll out your option, and let's start getting some authoritative flow into with that option going. And let's start hitting it right down the middle here. You know, it may seem unorthodox to people, but just like I was able to, where did I really, I was on the hole number 15. It was on hole number 15 that I really started hitting it great. I decided, you know what, let me just try this. What I got to lose? I haven't figured it out. I can't get off this course until I figure it out. I might as well just, so I had like a pocket full of balls, and I just kept teeing them up and hitting them and hitting them and hitting them and hitting them and hitting them. And they started working. I said, wow, this works. And so then again, I hit some more on, hit on 17, hit on 18. It worked great. It worked great on all those, you know, I realized, hey, I've got it. I've got it again. I got it. I refined it actually. It's even better than before. The way before it hurt my back a little bit. I had to change. So, but this way seems to be better. So it's a good sign. It's 15. Hole number 15 is when it started. Well, 215 is when it started. We start hitting it down the middle with authority. Hitting it with authority. So this is different. When you're on the golf course, you can tell if somebody's hitting the ball with authority or they're just hitting it. Most people are just hitting it. But if you up there and hit it with authority, people, they'll say something. They'll say, hey, great drive. Love that drive. Because they could feel it was hit with authority. In other words, there's no holding back. That there was just a sense of confidence that I'm hitting. I know what I'm doing. I'm hitting this with authority. I'm all in on this swing. I trust it. I trust my swing. I'm all in on it. Then, you know, you can tell. You can tell right off the bat. You can tell. Is somebody just trying to hit it out there, or someone just hitting it with authority? Really, really, you know, just wailing on it. Not even concerned. I know where it's going. You know, no problem. I know that. I know what I'm doing, and I'm not worried or frightened or anything. I'm just going all in here, all in on this shot. And when you pull it off, people say, "Oh, yeah, is that like that, man? That's great." Same thing spiritually. You know, we could tell if someone's all in, and they're moving with authority. You know, and they're hitting it down right down the middle, with a little draw, beautiful, just boom, boom, boom. You know, this works, this works, this works. You can tell if someone is really moving with true authority. It's something we pick up on that. So this is what we need right now. Of course, the UN agenda doesn't like that because none of them have real authority. They're just hitting the ball. They're not hitting it with authority. They don't have any authority at all. Well, they've tried to use authority, which is this is part of the problem. Maybe is it based on theosophy, the United Nations, Helena Blavatsky, Annie Besant, Alice Bailey, Joachim Moria, the so-called masters, the White Lodge, and so on. And they're tasked with the development of planet Earth. This is what they say. Now, you know, so it's sort of hard, you know, difficult to, I mean, it puts a stamp of authority on it in certain ways. And so it's difficult. These are not idiots. I mean, these people are not idiots by any stretch of the imagination. I mean, they're very, very, very intelligent people, actually. And they moved with a lot of authority back in the day of the heyday of theosophy. They had a ton of authority at the highest levels of government and bureaucracy, actually. These people were very powerful in England and Europe and the Illuminati and the aristocracy, etc. Theosophy got into the aristocracy, into the Illuminati of Europe. And they have this belief in the development of human consciousness, of our consciousness, and so. But it's not the non-dual teaching. It is not. It's developmental outcome teaching. So, it's you know, I cannot say with perfect certainty that there's no substance to develop, you know, that sort of slow path for humanity sort of thing. Because certainly most people are on the slow path, right? So they may be taking a very long-term approach, you know, long, big picture, long-term approach, possibly. And not to say that others might be jumping in with all sorts of mischief in there. But certainly they're not taking a quick short-term approach to it at all. You know, Jesus comes in with a Course in Miracles. It's quite different than theosophy, isn't it? Very, very different. He says, let's get it done now. You know, this is all an illusion. This is all pretense, which aligns perfectly with Ramana Maharshi and you know, some other teachers like Longchenpa, Ananda Maima, Srinivasagata Maharaj, Anamalai Guru, you know, Swami, etc., etc., etc. Yeah, they're all on the same page. They're all on the same page. Theosophy is not on that same page at all. They say that you have to gradually develop, you know, the planet. You know, the planet has chakras. We have chakras. You have to gradually bring those into better and better, you know, and go do altruistic action, et cetera, et cetera. You know, gradual, slow, grinded out path. So, you know, I'm not in a position to rule on this question authoritatively at all. I certainly believe in the non-dual way, absolutely. I've glimpsed the result of that, the abidance, and it exists for us. There's no question. And everything else is just an illusion. It's just pretense. You know, is there some slow, grinded-out way for 7 billion people on this planet to gradually move in that direction? Well, you know, I can't say for sure that there isn't. I hope there is, because they're certainly not getting with non-dual, true non-dual, very well at all, right? They've got to advance somehow. But it could be some bitter, 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 bitter stuff along that pathway. I mean, the great spiritual teachers tell us you need to go briskly. Briskly. And so, you know, it's That's never been resolved clearly enough. I mean, this the Great White Lodges on Sirius, they're, you know, they're extraterrestrials involved with all this, and they feel, you know, sustainable development goals is what they believe in. But the way that it's playing out here is this technocratic dictatorship, you know, bureaucracy. You know, it's looking very slimy right now. So, you know, I'd love to have Jesus show up and say, Jesus, what about Joaquin and Moria and Kuthumi and Saint Germain and all these, you know, ascended masters? I mean, what's the skinny on this, really? I mean, and not that everything they've said is seems off track, not necessarily, but they just seem, somehow they seem dualistic to me, you know? It smacks of dualism to me. But the big picture, you know, is hard to fathom what the ultimate big picture is. But we certainly in the short term can see that Agenda 21 isn't looking very appetizing. And what I saw in the dream, it's going into darkness. Very bad darkness. Now, it is a fact that Theosophy has over and over again admitted that they've made some great mistakes and errors. Even Joaquin said that the hierarchy thought that things were going to go a certain way, and it didn't go that way, it went a different way. So they're hardly infallible. I can't imagine Jesus saying such a thing. I mean, truth is true and nothing else is true. There's no outcomes at all. So, I mean, the idea that something can go in the wrong direction is antithetical to the non-dual approach, is nothing matters. There aren't any outcomes. It's all an illusion. It's pretense. Outcomes don't exist. Like Annamalai Swami said, that we just have to stop believing in it. All this, it doesn't have anything to do with reality. You know, outcomes is outcomes. What are you talking about? That's the wrong way. He talked about Ramana Maharshi. He used to like use this analogy of somebody. Somebody came to Ramana one day and said, "Ramana, I want to bury my shadow. I can't stand my shadow. I'm going to get rid of it. I'm going to bury it." Ramana said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah. How are you going to do that? Well, I'll show you." So he dug a big pit. And then stood there. And so his shadow was, you know, cast into the pit, right? The sun was behind casting the shadow into the pit. He said, "Watch this." Okay. So he started throwing dirt on the shadow. He says, "I'm burying my shadow." But no matter how much dirt he threw, the shadow kept being casted on the dirt that he'd thrown in there. And so eventually he'd filled up the whole pit as level as the ground, and the shadow was still there, just right now on the level ground. He didn't get rid of his shadow. And Ramana says, this is what we're trying to do with outcomes. You know, we keep trying to do it through outcomes. Getting a right outcome is delusion. He says that reinforces delusion, trying to get a right outcome. The whole problem is our belief in outcomes is the problem. This is our attempt to change reality. Perfect freedom can never be said to be engaged in an outcome, can it? And when you see this, it'll click for you. Just say, wait a minute. If I'm perfectly free to experience anything at any moment I want to, I'm never bound by any experience I have, how can I say I'm reaching an outcome? This is totally antithetical to reality, completely antithetical to it. So how can we really say, you know, like, I'm getting rid of my shadow by filling this pit up? You know, no. We're getting rid of outcomes by focusing on outcomes that we want. As the UN Agenda 21 says, this is what we really want. This is their motto. This is what everyone really wants. This is what we really want, meaning we, everybody. It's an outcome. These are the outcomes we want. But won't that just bind us even more to delusion? I say it must. It must. That's why they're believing some magical solution. So, you know, I don't really need to refute Theosophy in order to continue with, you know, non-duality is what we're doing. It's going to abidance. Because we have teachers who tell us for sure that's the goal. That's the goal. All right, for sure. So we don't really need to spend our time refuting, you know, not really. It's a waste of time. You know, and so we're not going to, I'm not going to bother one way or the other with that. We can just do neither nor. I neither accept it nor do I reject it. This is the best practice. I neither accept it nor reject it. So we don't get caught up in this battle of refute this, refute that. When we say, well, I neither accept nor reject any outcome whatsoever, this ultimately frees us, zeroes out the outcomes. And we say, it's okay, I have abidance. I realize there's no such thing as outcomes. That's fine, I'm fine with that. So I neither accept nor reject theosophy. You can say that. I neither accept nor reject the white brotherhood. I neither accept nor reject, you know, the theosophy. I neither accept or reject Agenda 21. I neither accept nor reject. This is the real practice that we need to do. We don't get caught up in battling with it. We just have to get familiar with this neither nor. I neither accept it nor do I reject it. In other words, I'm not looking for outcomes. I'm not looking to defeat this. I'm not looking to be right. I got the right outcome. No, I'm looking to abide in reality, you know, which is freedom, which is realization, and there's no such thing as outcomes. And this is what I experience in abidance is you're there and the feeling might be one of like, you see that there's no outcomes anywhere. And so this is a different feeling than what we're used to, a different awareness, different perspective, isn't it? I would say that comes closest to explaining it. No matter which direction, you look in all directions, you're aware of just an endless expanse where there's no concretization taking place, no outcomes ever taking place anywhere. That doesn't mean there's an absence of experience or anything. It's just there's no concretization of outcomes. There's no outcomes anywhere. So it's, everything is clear. You feel depth in being and experiencing in all directions, but it remains, you know, crystal clear, perfectly clear and seamless, utterly seamless. There's this perfect seamlessness. There's no concretization taking place at all. I would say this is, you know, a closer, you know, description, trying to at least give some sort of heads up on this is, so this is why we practice neither nor is so important. I neither accept nor reject. I neither refute nor do I not refute. Whatever anyone says, you know, no matter what, you take whatever you want, take Agenda 21, I neither accept it nor do I reject it. Because we're talking about what? Outcomes. That's what they're pushing for, is outcomes. Theosophy is pushing for outcomes. They may say the outcomes eventually lead to what we want, but what we want is realization of no outcomes. So it's much quicker to practice in this way, is I neither accept theosophy nor do I reject theosophy. I neither accept outcomes nor do I reject outcomes. I'm completely neutral. No outcomes. I'm not interested in any outcomes. I'm not interested in the outcome of defeating them, of refuting them, of being right. No, because then that keeps us from experiencing vision of oneness, the abidance in this perfect seamless no outcomeness, no concretizationness, perfect seamless clarity. It prevents it. It prevents it. So it's a Pyrrhic victory to try to refute somebody. Just say, I neither refute nor do I not refute. I neither refute this nor do I not refute it. This is a way better practice. This is the fast path, for sure. The way things are looking in this world, we want a fast path. We don't want a slow path right now. Because these so-called ascended masters, they keep saying, whoops, you know. I keep hearing the whoops, 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 whoops. Right? Like, oh, well, we thought this was going to happen, but something changed, and now we have to adjust because it's, you know, we didn't expect this to happen, and whoops. You know, we don't want these whoopses, you know. We want abidance now. We want abidance right now. So that's my aim, is abidance right now. I'm not going to fool around with these ascended masters trying to say that they know what's going on when they keep saying, well, you know, we thought the timetable was going to be like this, but it's all changed now, and God is mysterious. They probably run on some supercomputers that they telling them what thing's going to happen, and they come off like these great ascended masters. They're probably just extraterrestrials, you know. Well, some of them, I don't know, but they may be just extraterrestrials posing as these ascended masters so that we'll listen to what they say. And they're looking at supercomputers with all this data crunching, and then this, and then they think this is the way things are supposed to happen. They tell us, okay, this is what's going to happen. And when it doesn't happen, they say, whoops, God threw a curveball into the situation. God's very mysterious. We don't know what God's going to do exactly. We can think we know, but not exactly. What it really means is their computers weren't programmed to get the answer. These are very slimy, sneaky little expletives, in a lot of ways. And so they'll appear to us, as some ascended master, and but they're really just reading out something the computer spit out for them. And there's certainly supercomputers. They have ETs have supercomputers, so that's not a surprise to anybody, is it? We've got them here right now. They have even better ones. As we know, the exponential quantum leap of memory and speed and computing, it's supposed to go on and on and on and on and on. So we can certainly extrapolate that and think, wow, the ETs may have supercomputers that are, way beyond what we realize in terms of what their functioning is. And so these computers may be spitting out, these projections, which the ETs take as gospel. Strange thing, a funny thing happened on the way to the opera. It's like funny thing happened on the way to the future. It's the future isn't quite what it used to be, and these projections don't always play out. And then they have to say, like, then they blame it on God. It's not the computer's fault. It's not their fault. It's not their projections that are wrong. It's God decided to step in and change the picture somehow, and now they have to readjust. But don't worry, we're working on it. I mean, the computers are busy throwing spitting out another projection. It wouldn't be surprising at all if there weren't a lot of that going on. I certainly believe that there is. And they're not going to appear to us as ETs because they go, stay away. So they come as, ascended master, this ascended master, I've given you this information. Oh, yes. So how do you tell the difference between just an image of ascended master and the real deal? Well, you can tell the difference. You can. We all can tell the difference of the real McCoy. When the real McCoy shows up in this world, it's always been recognized as such. Or if it's an appearance that's the real McCoy, it's recognized as such. Because it's non-dual, no outcomes. It's just, you can tell that they have absolutely no attachment to any outcomes whatsoever. And yet they're still pragmatic enough to realize that you need to reach this acceptance of this truth, that abidance in this outcome-free eternal life. We do have to come to acceptance of that, so that they're aware of that. And they may speak in terms of that outcome, but it's the outcome-free outcome, you might say. It's the freedom from the belief in outcomes. So, if someone appeared to me and started teaching, talking about all this theosophy and outcomes, I'd say, I think I'd like to do better than this, really. I'd rather have a non-dual teacher show up. And I had a dream in which someone appearing as Jesus, posing as Jesus, showed up. And they start blah 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 about all these outcomes and frequencies and energy patterns, and I said, hey, wait a minute, this doesn't sound like Jesus to me. And then I had another dream where someone that I do believe Jesus showed up, and he said, I'm just here to just relate with you as a friend. That's it. So there's somebody who's not talking about any outcomes at all, are they? The other one was all agitated about some frequencies, the vibrational frequency of the planet that's been changing. That's the problem. You're not getting the proper resonance in your chakras, and blah, they went on all this technical esoteric stuff. I said, I don't know if you're really Jesus. This is not the Jesus I know. Jesus, I know, doesn't talk that way. He talks a very non-dual way. Very, very non-dual way. Wonderfully non-dual way. And then so he says, just saying, hey, I'm just back here just to relate with you, just as a friend. That's it. I just want to, you know, maybe tell crack jokes just as a friend here. I don't have any other agenda or anything, anything else to say, really. I just here, just want to hang out as friends with you. Relate as friends. I felt like this is a legitimate Jesus, you know. And the other one was a poser. You know, perhaps a front for an extraterrestrial, you see. So there is a difference. You can get the difference. Your spirit will recognize a difference there. Wow. Did you hear that? Holy cow. Huge animal was just in the front yard here. Whew. I don't have a... But we can tell by the... that was a big, big buck deer. Good Lord. They could hear the weight of that thing was suddenly charged through the front yard right close to where I'm sitting here. It's pitch dark. I can't see anything. I guess I should have a flashlight out here. But you could tell when it got out on the road, the click of the hoofs on the asphalt. Holy cow. How extraordinary. A day of deer. But that was a huge animal. And they were running frantically, bounding right through here. That was just amazing. I got kind of a little worried right there. Because there's nothing, you know, keeping them from jumping in here. I was ready to stand up and clap my hands and try to drive them away. Boy, my heart is just racing right now. Wow, there's another huge wow today. Maybe that's the ET fake Jesus that suddenly flees, you know, flees like they've been outed. That animal was heavy. You could feel the earth shake when it was bounding there. Thud, thud, thud. I don't know if you picked it up on the microphone. That's an animal weighing like, you know, 300 pounds or something. That was a huge animal. I don't know what it was at first. I couldn't place it in my mind. I mean, ordinarily a smaller deer would not make that kind of... would not feel the thudding of the earth like that. But I can't... I mean, there's no other animal in this area that would be like that. That was a big buck. With horns on it, you know, right? It's completely pitch dark. I can't see a thing. So, what is it that it was right? Just must have been sitting in the front yard, and then something startled it. I don't know what startled it. Deers, when they get startled, jumping around. I mean, that's not a good thing. There's nothing to eat here. I don't know why they were here. There's no plants. Everything's dead. Pretty much so. Wow. That caused a tremendous reaction. That was scary. Whole system is shaking from that. So I'll just accept it. Thank you, Holy Spirit, you know, for this shocker right there. In hindsight, we'll, you know, explain what was that all about. Never had that happen before. At least they didn't jump on the car. They were leaping. That's when they came down. That's why the thud when they came down. They were leaping around. It wasn't walking. They were leaping. Somebody was eavesdropping. A deer was eavesdropping on this. Maybe there's someone else out there eavesdropping and startled the deer. I don't know. Possible. I can't see anything. Oh well, you know. It is what it is. Hey, that's a nice way. What time is it here? 10:30, September 30th. Whew, that's quite a kickoff to October, isn't it? Today has been full of surprises. Very startling surprises. Those turkeys really surprised the heck out of me. You don't feel you're walking down with your head down, and you kind of look up, and then staring right at you are these five huge turkeys. You know, you never in your mind think you'll ever see such a thing. And the backdrop is all these oak trees of Spanish moss and everything. And it's like the picture out of some, you never even imagined such a picture, such a backdrop, such a situation. It's just, I mean, it was, you know how weird turkeys look. These are gobblers, male turkeys, gobblers. And with all these Spanish moss and this, you know, like it looks like a land that time forgotten. These five big turkeys looking over their turkey eyes, you know, staring at me like this. I don't know what to say. Yeah, I didn't know what to say. What to do? I said, you know, wow. Kind of stared right back at him. So it's been one startling situation after another today. This one, it's the icing on the cake, it's the cheesecake. It's the dessert, wow. That's about as startling as like an almost could be in an accident or something. Same sort of whoa, 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 whoa reaction there. May have a hard time sleeping tonight, that's for sure. It could mean our frontal self. Something just left our frontal self. We somehow startled it and it left. Maybe it's the influence of ETs. Maybe it's the influence, you know, somehow. Maybe something is fleeing from us out of our whole frontal self. Because the truth is now emerging. You know, the apocalypse is lifting the veil on it. And they said they got to just flee. They suddenly just bolt like that. You know, we're drawing back the veil, lifting the veil on a lot of stuff right now. Maybe they can't handle the light. Because we're neither rejecting nor are we not rejecting it. We're neither dismissing nor not dismissing. We're neither evaluating nor are we not evaluating. We're neither reacting nor are we not reacting. We're neither disputing nor are we not disputing. We're neither disputing nor are we not disputing. Neither disputing, nor are we not disputing. Neither refuting, nor are we not refuting. Neither rejecting, nor are we not rejecting. It's very important to practice in this way instead of getting pulled into dualistic polarization battle, you know, outcome battle. This is what hides truth from us. This is what the great non-dual teachers tell us. This is what hides truth from us. We don't see it. So there may be something in the darkness that the light that we're shedding here is too much for it, and it needs to flee. Possible. And there's something there just hanging out in the darkness here that suddenly decided it had to flee. something startled the heck out of it. I mean, maybe it's just our, you know, the light that we're bringing here. Or maybe it was a mouse. I don't know. Some little creature, a cat. A cat startled it. I don't know. Or maybe a guru startled it. Maybe the guru is coming into our frontal awareness. And this deer, you know, became aware of it in its subtle body or something and took off. Couldn't handle it. Scared it away. Wow. This created a tsunami of wowness in me. Holy Spirit's full of surprises. Which is great, you know. It's great cause when everything's fine. It's great. This one's gonna take a while to calm down from that. Felt like a rhinoceros was out there. It really did. That's a real clumpy creature, isn't it? You know, what are some other clumpy creatures? Are they the way they go thump 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 like that? I don't know. Big cats don't do it that way. They're very stealthy and quiet. You know, zebras, gazelles, wildebeest, bulls. My bull, you could say, could have been a bull right there. Yeah, big bull. Absolutely. Big cattle would do that. Those with hooves. It was definitely an animal with hooves, seemed like. Giraffe might sound that way. A mountain goat, bighorn sheep, elk, reindeer. Certainly a big elk would that way. A moose would sound like that. Yeah, like a moose. They're big, right? I mean, something like a moose in your front yard, but there's no moose here. A bear wouldn't sound that way. some kind of shock treatment, for sure. Wow. Okay, well, something's happening, right? I mean, stuff is happening. That you know, hopefully that's good. That's good. A lot has happened today. Very startling. Very startling. Powerful. Beautiful. Surreal. Those turkeys were completely surreal. Maybe the most surreal scene I've ever come across in my life were those five big turkeys, just staring at me like, you know, like, what are you doing? Who are you? What are you doing? I don't know what they were thinking. How do you know what a turkey's thinking? But they were certainly very interested in me, you know, walking. Had a full attention, these turkeys. But they were absolutely still. Too much, too much. Very, completely, if I had a picture, that would be absolutely surreal, the whole thing. But you can't capture this whole surrealness in a picture, really. And then the beauty, the stunning beauty of the sunset, and then this startling, severe startling here, of a sudden departure, a startle of a sudden departure here. Oh, boy. Yeah, deer are all over, I guess, now. They're coming down. There's dry in the hills. They're coming down looking for water. I mean, there's so many deer. But, so they come down into residential areas now. This has happened before. We have the best way to put up deer fencing. Some people put up deer fencing We got like a trace of rain here today, just enough to slightly wet the surface of everything. Just a tiny, tiny few, you know, drops here and there. That's about it. Very, very, very slight. I don't think it was even measurable. It wasn't even measurable. But we got enough just to sort of feels damp. We're told that this year El Nino in California is going to hit Southern California with there's above average and way above average. They expect way above average rain in Southern California, above average rain in central northern California. So we're thinking we're going to get above average rainfall. Southern California is going to get higher than above average. What do you say? Above average? Above average? Way above average. Yeah. They're going to get way above average rainfall from El Nino, which has been clobbering Mexico. They're just getting extreme amount of rain. So as the Earth tilts and jet stream changes, and then, you know, autumn comes into winter and stuff, they feel that a lot of that moisture is going to flow up into Southern California. Yeah, you know, talking about mudslides, look out, huge amount of mudslides there. But, you know, it's not, it's, usually it impacts a few homes here and there. But you don't know. We don't know. I mean, LA could flood. It's possible. I mean, they have these huge culverts that run through the city watershed. they can carry a ton of water, really. They could turn to raging torrents, but there are these concrete culverts that go through the city, waterways that handle these, you know, flash floods and such. But if we get, you know, severe El Nino, you know, it's conceivable that Los Angeles could flood. You know, I mean, that I don't know if that's ever happened, Los Angeles flooding. Storm drains, you know, storm, flash floods, storm waterways. They're big, they're deep, but if those flooded and went into Los Angeles, that would be something. And if you get enough mud coming down from the hillsides, it can flow into those, and enough debris and everything coming down, it could block them up, you know. So I mean, it's conceivable. We're worried about potential flooding actually in California. It's possible. You know, like Tokyo got flooded, didn't it? I mean, I don't know how that happened, but it's quite extraordinary. I mean, I used to live in Tokyo. I don't see how, you know, Tokyo could flood like that. I don't know, I didn't look into the story. I'm not looking into stories, but you know, if Tokyo can flood, I guess LA can flood too. Can San Francisco flood? Not really. It's built on hills. It, you know, it's not flat. It's not like a floodplain sort of situation. Can North Bay flood? The possible. South Bay possible. East Bay possible. So California could experience a flooding. It is possible. With the inundation, what causes floods is huge amounts of precipitation really coming down fast. Like you hear people, places like getting, you know, 18 inches in 24 hours or something, you know, that's what causes flooding. Could knock out the subway in LA, underground. I think they have subway and a lot of transportation systems that could, you know, could cause problems there. I'm just trying to calm down from that situation that happened with that deer. They have all these concrete, like aqueducts, or you know, waterways that go through the city. It's amazing. Without those, they would flood. That is for sure. Maybe that deer was pointing out something. There might be some extreme agitation suddenly happening in the world, you know? Maybe that was a messenger. I mean, that was like scary conflict there. Boom, 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 boom. Maybe something really is about to erupt somewhere that could cause severe agitation. So, we need the Holy Spirit to roll out its option, you know, right away, with authority. We're ready for the authority. I certainly am. And pass the authority on down the line, right? It can have a wonderful cumulative effect down the line as authority's given out, experienced here, it's passed on, they pass it on, they pass it on, they pass, and it creates this wonderful effect. So that's what we're hoping for right now, aiming for right now. And if that experience of that deer is any indication, something is heavy is about to happen, very heavy. Although we're talking about a heavyweight, you know, hoping we need a heavyweight. Well, there was a heavyweight right in our front yard, that is for sure. You could feel that, how heavy that was. I could feel it. I said, this is a large, huge animal there. Don't mess with that animal, I guarantee you. I just think. Heavyweight. So maybe heavyweight's coming. I don't know. Something is going to happen, right? Something big time is going to happen. Will happen soon. So here we go into October. October surprise. October is the spiritual month. It is the spiritual month in my experiencing. So be, you know, we're lean, mean, with a full head of steam, and we're ready for it. That's the way, the attitude. Glasses half full, absolutely half full. We will not be crushed. We will not go into a fetal position. We will not be drawn into conflict or disputes or anything like that. We will be practicing. I neither dispute this, nor do I not dispute this. See, I neither dispute this, nor do I not dispute this. Try using that for everything that bothers you. Everything about Agenda 21, which is hugely bothersome for many, for good reason, right? So I neither dispute this, nor do I not dispute it. Try that. Get familiar with it. This is like a ticket to paradise, really. I neither dispute this, nor do I not dispute it. And there's something within you that will accept this and say, that's good enough. That's good. Now, let me just abide in this outcome-free reality, which is so perfect, completely perfect. I'm ready for abidance. Ultimately, this is what we want, ultimately. So let's keep practicing. I neither dispute this, nor do I not dispute it. And that's all I'm going to say about it. I neither dispute this, nor do I not dispute it. I'm neither taking action, nor am I not taking action. I'm neither taking action on this, nor am I not taking action. I neither accept this, nor do I not accept it. I neither reject this, nor do I not reject it. And, you know, treat yourself well. Make sure you eat well enough. I'm kind of minimizing my food right now. Trying to win this battle, at least slim down a little bit. It's super difficult for me. Basically, you know, either if I have to starve myself. But I don't want to do that. But still, I'm still holding the line, you know, trying to slim down a little bit here. Feel a little more mobile, a little more agile. I'm getting there, bit by bit, slowly. Stretching, starting to stretch more. which is really, helpful. Playing a little, starting to play golf again. That there's a lot of bending and stretching and climbing hills and down and all. So you very use your body in a lot of different ways with golf. Actually, you feel quite tired after a round of golf, especially if you're in a mountainous golf course. You feel very tired, very achy and sore and tired. It's not cardio, that's for sure. But you do, if you do walk briskly, your heart rate does get up actually quite a bit. If you're going up steep hills and down side hills and all this kind of stuff, yeah, you feel it. So doing that, getting the rust off, we want to be positive in October. Class is half full. We're calling for some authority to really help a chain of authority. We really want to help us out. We practice the neither nor. I'm neither accepting this nor am I rejecting it. Either accepting this nor am I rejecting it. I'm neither ruling on this nor am I not ruling on this. I'm neither judging this nor am I not judging this. I neither approve of this nor do I not approve of it. I neither approve of this nor do I not approve of this. Practice this. This is a profound practice. And what are we practicing for? For some huge breakthrough? No. To get familiar with it. Get familiar with this. And the more familiar with it, the easier it becomes, and then we can do whatever tweaking we need to do to perhaps to just gently transition into abidance, into this total non-concretized, no outcome experience of fullness, of allness, of inclusivity, perfect inclusivity. No one can ever concretize, no one can ever become an outcome, you see. We're all free, we're all sovereign, perfectly untouched by outcomes. We're all eternal life, and we can experience this actually while we're here. There are those who have. So I'm going to wrap this up soon, perhaps, and get back in the house and maybe feel a little safer from that creature, that heavyweight creature. I didn't try to figure out what the turkeys were thinking. I just looked at them and said, I'm just going to walk on and continue with my day. I'm not going to try to figure out what you're standing there for, looking at me for. Think, what are you thinking? Right? So don't try to figure turkeys out. The world's a turkey. Don't try to figure it out. That we just say, I'm neither going to figure it out, nor am I not going to figure it out. I'm either going to try to figure it out, nor am I not going to try to figure it out. And let's just leave it at that. Let's just leave it at that. Okay, very great. Just ask the Holy Spirit for, blessings upon us, and thank Holy Spirit for all the great help it's going to give us in October. The awesome wow of October 2015 will never be another month like it. The awesome wow of October 2015. Thank gratitude, full gratitude to the Holy Spirit for setting this all up for us. Very great. All right, that's